And finally, to the analysis of Shields and Brooks. Judy Woodruff is with them tonight.
That's, of course, syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Good to see you both. Gentlemen, let's start out with health care. David, we're a week away from Congress coming back from the August recess. Where does this big battle stand, and especially now that Ted Kennedy's gone?
Well, it's still not good if you're looking for passage. If you look at the president's approval rating, they were up at 70 a couple months ago. Now they've steady decline down to about 50, around there. If you look at public view of the health care plan specifically, it's a slight majority against, but that seems to be pretty hard. So what I'd expect the administration to do is to do two things. One, actually come out with their own plan, try to relaunch this with their own plan. And second, do something dramatic, maybe have a joint session of Congress speech, something like that, to really relaunch the debate. Because the way it's going now, I don't think there's a member of Congress who is moderate or leaning who has leaned in favor in the last couple months. And a number and many have been sort of leaned a little against.
Is that how you're reading it, Mark?
Sadly, I agree with David on most of what he said. Judy, it's not a question of messaging. The president is an effective messenger. People like Barack Obama as president. They want him to succeed. Bill McIntyre, the Republican pollster, John McCain's pollster, made that point to me as recently as yesterday. But the problem is, I think, the content. I really do. And I think whether you call it relaunching, rebranding, whatever, they've got to come out with what they want. There are, interestingly enough, consensus is emerging, as others have pointed out as well. I mean, there is an agreement that there wasn't 15 years ago about insurance companies, that they cannot deny coverage because of a pre-existing condition, that they can't take away coverage when somebody gets sick, that they want to remove the limits on lifetime benefits received. But insurance companies legitimately and understandably are saying, look, if all the reform is going to be us, you know, what's to prevent anybody from just saying, I'll wait until I get sick before I buy health insurance? So, I think there's consensus that is emerging that you could do, but that has nothing to do with the costs and controlling the costs over the long run, and not a heck of a lot to do with extended coverage. But I think there's an emerging consensus as well about providing subsidies for people to get health insurance who can't afford it, to small businesses to provide it who can't afford it. So I think that there is a consensus, and this is where Ted Kennedy is so dearly and acutely missed, because he could seize that kind of an opening.
But if there is an opening, if there are these emerging consensuses, David, then why is it so hard to do this?
Well, there are three things. First, the country is nervous about the whole government changing, getting too big. It comes in the wake of the takeover of AIG, the takeover of the car companies, radical expansion of government and other things. So people are just extremely anxious. Then, secondly, people are afraid of cutting benefits. They're going to cut Medicare by $500 billion. They want to cut it in ways that won't hurt health care costs. People are a little dubious. And then there's the matter of costs, Mark alluded to. Barack Obama started this as a cost control measure. There's no real serious cost control in there. And in some ways, he tried to be politically smart. And the smart thing was, you can't take away people's existing health care. And that was politically intelligent. The problem is, if you're going to preserve that much of the current system, you're not going to be able to control costs. There was another option sitting out there, this thing called the Wyden-Bennett plan, which had bipartisan support, but would have really altered people's health care to give people more consumer choice.
Take
away the employer tax credit and give people a subsidy. But that really would have shook up the system, and they decided that was too politically difficult. They didn't want something that radical. But by keeping so much of the current plan, they haven't solved a lot of the current system's problems.
But Mark, if the president needs to weigh in, does he simply need to re-explain it, or does he have to change his position?
I think he has to change his position. I think they have to acknowledge the president is an effective, brilliant, compelling communicator. Yet during the month that he had to make his case, the numbers went down. And I think at some point you have to acknowledge that the message, the old line, Judy, about they don't like the dog food. I mean, when they put out the best can, the best advertising campaign, the best grocery store placement of this brand new dog food, the dogs didn't like it. It is not, the plan is now and is not selling. And I think that the president, it's more than just refashioning the message.
And the question is, does he go big or does he go small? Mm-hmm. There are a number of people like Joe Lieberman saying, no, let's pull
big
back.
Meaning
let's,
more expensive?
More expansive or more radical change.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the radical change is the Wyden-Bennett thing. But the small is the more incremental approach. Expand coverage, give people some of the health insurance, seize on the things Mark was talking about that a lot of people agree with, but maybe not try to do everything all at once. Just do some more things so more people are covered.
Mark, you were starting to say that it does make a difference that Senator Kennedy is gone.
Yes.
How so exactly? What, I mean, we knew that he was not likely to come back to
Washington. No, but Judy, I mean, what has been mostly ignored in the tributes, which have been remarkable to Ted Kennedy, is that Ted Kennedy, at a fundamental level, was a brilliant politician in a human sense. Mitch McConnell, whom he wasn't close, the Republican leader, told the story to Jim Carroll when John Barrasso came into the Senate, there was a reception for him in 2007, Senator from Wyoming. Nobody probably knew him, couldn't pick him out of the police lineup. One Democrat showed up, Ted Kennedy, and he spent all the time talking to Barrasso's family and his children. And that's, I mean, that gift, that ability to reach across that line, that you were never a permanent adversary, there was no enemies in Ted Kennedy's, and Ted Kennedy, you know, could understand where somebody was, and he could grab an opening. If he saw an opening here, those are big consensuses. Those are a lot bigger points that made it where they agree than the silliness about the death tribunals, you know, for old age and letting grandma. I mean, these are really big policies, and that's where that was his gift. And once he made his commitment, he could then sell it to the Democrats because Ted Kennedy was the tribune of modern liberalism. Nobody could question, say, oh, did he sell out? I mean, when he collaborated with Nancy Kassenbaum on portability, we with Orrin Hatch on S-CHIPs and children's health coverage, I mean, that's a special gift.
Do you think his presence would have made a difference?
Well, he had that special gift, but it was always in favor of smaller and incremental changes. He's wanted a national health care system for decades, but he hasn't been able to get it because the political culture just hasn't been there, even when you have a majority of Democrats. So he's had important incremental accomplishments, the children's health care system being, I think, the most important. But he hasn't had to be able to get the big national thing. And personally, for all the gifts, I'm a little dubious he would have made a big difference now, because the opposition is out in the country, and it's just to the plan itself. Charlie Cook, I mentioned this last week, said it's more likely that there'll be 20 House losses than less losses of seats in the next election. So if you're going to lose your job, well, you love having Ted Kennedy pay attention to you, but it's probably not going to affect your vote.
Speaking of seats, how much difference does it make to Democrats whether they get a successor to Ted Kennedy named quickly, changing the law, which is what Senator Kennedy wanted done, and it's the flip side of what Democrats were asking for not long ago.
Massachusetts Democrats are redefining hypocrisy politically. I mean, we've always kind of regarded hypocrisy as a given. They changed the law in 2004 to deny a Republican governor the power to appoint the successor to President-elect John Kerry. That was Mitt Romney. John Kerry did not win. So in 2009, with the death of Ted Kennedy, now they want and replaced it with a special election that was mandated. Now they want to have an interim senator appointed by the Democratic governor, Deval Patrick, while the special election. If the special election, Judy, will not be held, according to the Secretary of State, until January 19th or January 26th, 2010. So that means the Democrats are without that 60th seat, and Massachusetts without a senator for all that time.
Does that one vote, David, does that make a lot of difference in the Senate? 15, if the Democrats have 59 votes?
I actually probably think not. I mean, every vote is important. There are only 100 votes. But I think that, with the Hillary care, it didn't even come to a vote. You get a sense of where it's going. People do not want to take an uncomfortable vote that's going to cost them seats unless they're sure it's going to pass. And that probably means by more than one seat. On the Massachusetts thing, I just find it offensive. I mean, the Constitution is not a ping pong ball. You don't change it from year to year depending on your own political advantage. You don't change the rules. The rules are the rules. And whoever, if they name a senator through this interim procedure, that senator will be tainted by the fact that it was so transparently naked a political ploy.
Let me ask you both.
Unless it's somebody of, towering reputation.
Right. Michael Dukakis.
Paul Kirk, somebody like that who's really respected across the board.
Just to fill the seat for the time being. All right, the story that came out earlier this week, terror suspects being not only harshly interrogated, but abused allegedly at the hands of the CIA. We're now reading more and more, including a story in the New York Times today about how the Justice Department and the CIA are maybe even more at war, David, than we thought. Where's all this headed?
Well, nowhere good. First, I hate the idea of a special prosecutor involved in something so political. Why are they prosecuting the lower-level guys, not the higher-level guys? Why did they not prosecute when career prosecutors looked at a couple of years ago, and now they are prosecuting? And then secondly, on the CIA, I had an old Washington hand say to me the other day, you do not want to go to war with the CIA. They keep every document. They're really good at this. And there's some danger that the Obama administration and the White House is perceived in the CIA as going to war with the CIA. Now, the Obama administration and the White House did not want to do what I think what Justice Eric Holder wants to do at the Justice Department. He was off on his own. But I think there's a perception in the CIA that they are being attacked. They're not being defended when they're being attacked by outsiders. And there's a great deal of friction right now, I think, between the CIA and the White House.
How odd to have the White House in one place and the Justice Department over here.
Well, we didn't have it for the last 8 years. I mean, there was no question right. that the political office right. of the White House and the Justice Department were more than chummy. It was a wholly owned subsidiary. Eric Holder is an interesting case. He left as Deputy Attorney General tarnished. In large part because he had been too subservient to the Clinton White House on the pardon, the unforgivable pardon, let it be noted, of Mark Rich by President Bill Clinton on the way out the door. And Holder had raised no objections to it. And he obviously is going to make sure that that doesn't happen again. If he were pleasing the White House right now, he would not be proceeding with this because the Obama White House would prefer that it go away. But I don't think there's any question, Judy, that what is most fascinating, I mean, first of all, you've got the Geneva Convention, you've got the UN resolution on treaty on torture, and recommended, championed by Ronald Reagan. And so that puts us in a serious bind. I mean, it's not simply torture, it's cruel and unusual treatment as well that is outlawed. And so that is the position. Interestingly and fascinating to me is the division between people who have served in uniform and been exposed to it, like Pete Peterson, the former ambassador, John McCain, Colin Powell, John Shalit Kashvili, General Joe Hoare, General Anthony Zinni. They are totally for subscribing to outlawing all forms of torture, whereas the civilian warriors, in many cases, seem to be showing their toughness by endorsing it.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, I was just going to say, on the left, you've got folks criticizing the Justice Department for not doing enough.
Right. The question is how we settle this. You know, look what those guys did, what they told people, we're going to kill your daughters, we're going to rape your daughters, that should never happen. The question is whether we settle it through a political means, which is what I support, or whether we send prosecutors in and settle political differences through prosecutorial means. And that, I'm not totally against it, but it raises a lot of problems, I think.
David Brooks, Mark Shields, thank you both.